to Ucypher, Naya Sport, Naya Superstars. We're bang in the middle of our first semi-finals between the Akramaks and the Yakshas. The Yakshas are leading with 6 points and just 1 point below are the Akramaks. Our teams are bouncing with energy. There's so much excitement happening here. The crowd is about to go berserk and there's so much nervous energy that the arena is going to blow up. But before that happens, let me just remind you that everything is going to boil down to our last multiplayer game, Dota 2.
Dire's ban now.
Radiant's turn to ban.
The Dire get a ban.
Here's the Radiant ban.
Dire's turn to pick. Ten seconds.
Radiant's turn to pick.
Crystal Maiden.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Ucypher. We are now in the playoffs. You're watching the Yakshas face off versus the Akramaks. The Yakshas did lose their game of Counter-Strike today, and a lot depends whether they can perform under pressure and win the game that matters the most today for them. The game of Dota 2 versus the Akramaks.
Interestingly enough, this is the decider match. Yakshas did win both their single player games, and the winner of this match moves on to the finals. Akramaks, no hesitation though. They've come in with a plan. They haven't had the best run through this tournament, but hey, it's never too late to come online.
Yeah.
Disruptor and Centaur are going to be their opening duo after a Medusa, Lich, and a Legion Commander ban. Finally, someone's banning out the Lich and the Medusa versus the Yakshas.
Yeah. And I sense this Crystal Maiden might result in a Storm pick. The 15% mana cost, mana loss reduction, not as great. But they banned out the Medusa, they banned out the Lich, the Spectre still slips through.
I mean, a best of one semi-final, you're going to take no risks whatsoever. You know that Akrid loves running that Spectre. It's had immense success for the side of Yakshas. Why stop picking it up now?
But the Centaur is good. I mean, you can stampede and run away from the Hawk, which is going to help. And even if there is the possibility of a Storm Spirit that the Yakshas might be considering, you've got the Disruptor, Static Storm is great. And for now, there's enough lockdown to deal with a slippery mid laner.
Yeah, I do like the Disruptor versus a potential Storm Spirit pickup. The problem is, if the Storm does opt to go for a Yules early on or a BKB, he's going to be immune to most of that. Akramaks, though, they've got bans on the board before they decide their next picks. On the other side, the Yakshas, we're just going to backtrack a little bit. They chose to first ban the Visage. This is not something we see being done too often. They're just protecting themselves versus possible cheese strats coming out from Akramaks. Like we said, best of one semi-final. Both teams are walking on thin ice. Yakshas may have the upper... Well, they may have had the upper hand up until now. But in a best of one, anything goes.
Yep.
We've got the Terror Blade ban coming from Yakshas, so they're protecting themselves versus an all-out fusion push. While Akramaks are going to go ahead and ban out the Nightstalker along with the Tinker. Now, Nightstalker is a funny hero. He's got some immense synergy with the Spectre, given that the Desolate now takes away your vision as well if it does connect. And of course, Nightstalker, he's adept at taking away your vision during the nighttime anyway.
Akramaks, they are looking for a 4 position. Now, Clockwork's been left in the pool. It's one of Butter or VP's go-to heroes, and Akramaks could snag it up if they want to. There's nothing wrong with... I mean, 90% of the time, Clockwork works in almost any draft.
But we know that they like running the Earth Spirit every now and then. We've seen Blue Frog running it in the past.
Yeah, Blue Frog has played it once with mixed success.
No success, actually. Oh, wow, this I like.
I like this.
I believe this is the first Tiny pickup of this entire tournament, and it's about damn time. Tiny is pretty broken at the moment.
Navi's been picking him a lot. VP has picked him every now and then. He's a pain in the lane. The thing is, there are a couple of safe laners who you can almost
leave by themselves.
Like, say, the Razor does well versus most melee offlaners, or the Monkey King does well versus most melee offlaners. Tiny's one of them. He picks up a tree, smacks you with that cleave, even throws that tree upon you for good measure. And he's pretty much self-sufficient. He's also one of those that could be building a silver edge this game to deal with the Spectre if need be. And status resistance, man. That's the hot word. Right now.
Yakshas, though, they're not going to take this lying down. Sure, they've thrown a curveball on the side of the Akramaks, but the one fallacy or the one chink in Tiny's armor is the fact that he has zero armor right up until the end of the game.
Yeah.
What better way to exploit that than to take armor reduction over and above it?
Five
physical
seconds
DPS,
remaining.
It's going to hurt him a hell of a lot. You've got Spectre, who already does a truck ton of damage when the Desolate kicks in. And couple that with the Slaughter, I think they've got enough to deal with this Tiny. This is one of those games where I'd like to see a possible BKB on the Spectre, though. Eventually, you want to have a way to reliably pound away on the Tiny without being focused, stunned, tossed, etc. But not early on, of course. I think Spectre's probably going to rush the Radiance at the first opportunity she gets. What Akramaks could do, though, with this Tiny pickup is run an offensive tri-lane that could slow the Spectre's growth in the early stages of the game. And Tiny is one of those that packs a hell of a punch early on, given that first point in the tree grab, assuming he puts it in there. Yakshas, though, they can still augment this physical DPS lineup with a Templar Assassin pick in the middle lane. In fact, if there was ever a time to pick up the TA, now it is.
Yeah.
Meld synergy with this with the Corrosive Haze, I think it's a good choice for them in the middle lane.
Gives them some push potential. Tiny's going to have a hard life in the mid-game. TA will also be building that BKB. So she could also be one of those that decides to jump upon the Tiny. Force Tiny to build defensive items if need be. I'm in favor of the Templar Assassin pick. But Akramaks, they're looking for four position here.
Earth Spirits, one of those that comes to mind. Alternatively,
Dire's turn to
Okay,
so it's a four-position
Radiant Band.
No hesitation. Yakshas will pick up the Templar Assassin.
They're going to pick up the Templar Assassin.
And again, with the TA coming out against the Lifestealer, that's physical DPS versus him. And take a look at Akramaks' lineup. They have almost no damage over time. I mean, the Avalanche does count as multiple ticks of damage, but when you've got the BKB on Templar Assassin, that refraction isn't going down.
Yeah.
Lifestealer needs to hit you six times to take down the maxed out refraction as well. I love the TA pick from Yakshas. It's going to be a really devastating pickup against Akramaks if TA can get a good start, though. Akramaks, there's no Viper for them to pick up. They have the option to pick up the Queen of Pain if they wanted to, but they're going to need a lot more damage over time right now than just that one Shadow Strike. And to that end, I like the Venomancer for them.
Yeah, I was just going to suggest that. Mid Venomancer, man. Why not?
But the Venomancer is Tiny Go.
They banned out the Venomancer. Smart ban coming out from the Yakshas here.
I think Akramaks is running this as a mid lane Tiny.
A mid Tiny?
Yeah, I think this is a mid Tiny, a safe lane Lifestealer, and an off lane Centaur. In which case, they're still
looking. In which case, they've held on to their four position pick till the end.
10 seconds.
It's unconventional, but at this point, you could pick up a Jakiro and have two pseudo four and five positions with the Disruptor and the Jakiro. And you will have the damage over time, the Dual Breath and the Liquid Fire. It's going to work versus that Templar Assassin and Refraction charges. You'd also have a bit of pushing potential that comes out with the Jakiro. And hey, more lockdown, because why not?
Okay.
What else could Akramaks go for as a four? I mean, do you foresee this as a Tiny four position?
That's what I was wondering to myself. I mean, it's unusual for Akramaks to just pick up the Tiny and run him mid this early on into the draft. They've come with a plan. Maybe they've given away too much by just picking up this Tiny early on. If this Tiny is going to the mid lane, I'm actually not a fan of Tiny mid this game.
I think it works.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, Templar's going to farm just fine, but the creep wave under the Tiny Star was not really a problem.
Okay.
He can last it over there. The only thing is the lack of armor on Tiny is going to hurt. Because all TA has to do is put that early point into the meld and smack the Tiny every time he comes forward.
Yeah.
On the side of Yakshas, though, they need an offlaner.
Khalnag's like, hero.
Basically Khalnag's.
Bunch of them have been banned out. The Void's been banned out. The LC's been banned out. Tide taken out of the equation. Offlane hero for Khalnag.
Batrider, Axe.
Yeah, a lot of options. I like the Axe.
Clockwork, maybe. Even a Necroforce wouldn't be too bad, even though that's not a conventional offer. But it'll be the Earthshaker. Okay. Completely slip through right till the very end.
So if this is a mid-tiny, they're looking for a 4. And they're going to go with the Ember Spirit.
That's not a 4 then. It looks like it's going to be the 4 position tiny after all. It's very unconventional. I mean, I've always been in favor of the core tiny, but I wonder if Akramaks has studied the map and come into this game with some new shenanigans, some new pull shenanigans, possibly at the middle lane.
I'm not a fan of so many melee heroes. It's a good game to be a Slada and or an Earthshaker.
Yeah, and a Templar Assassin with a Hurricane Pike for that matter.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that will be overcome with the Stampede movement speed. I think Centaur does plug that hole quite well. But, you know, for things that Akramaks have going on for them, they've got a lot of tankiness, man. They've got mobility with the Ember Spirit. Kiko's hard to kill. Make-Believe's got magic immunity, so stuns won't mean much versus him. Blue Frog, he's going to have status resistances later. And you've got Centaur, who, if he gets an Aghanim Scepter, just buffs up everyone else.
Yeah.
I like their late game. Honestly, I think Akramaks has a really strong late game lineup here. Their mid game is going to be explosive as well. The only thing they have to worry about is getting chopped to bits with the armor reduction from the Slada. If you can shut down the Slada early, prevent him from getting that blink dagger within the first 20 minutes of the game, and while you're doing that, somehow make some rotations towards the TA and slow her down as well, I think you've got what it takes to deal with the Spectre in the late game. I think I need to restart Dota here. My camera
system's broken. Yeah, even I've got to restart Dota. I'm going to quickly restart mine.
Yep. Just valve things. Camera broken. But yeah, while we do that, quick predictions, Vivek. Who do you think is coming out on top in this game?
I was feeling very as to what the... Okay, I have a strange theory as to what the Akramaks are going to be trying. I think they're going to try and toss in the center and get as many easy kills with a hoof stomp. It's very Dota 1, Dota 1 pub. But this is what I'm predicting, and I think it's going to work for them, actually. Finally came up for air.
Make believe. He's heading towards the middle lane on that lifesteal, but he's going to move towards bottom, I assume. Butter, he's got himself an observer ward, another two observer wards to be placed down. One's going to be placed down on the side here, that's going to give them vision of the middle lane. It's also going to block out this ancient camp for what it's worth, although it doesn't really matter this early on.
Yeah.
This is a nice ward actually. It's going to give them a fair bit of vision on the middle lane. It covers the slopes, which is what's important. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, Khalnayak and Punk moving bottom. They're going to be able to secure the bounty rune for themselves. It's one bounty rune apiece. No one actually went for the top dire bounty rune. So Akris just playing it super safe, expecting someone to have come in their way, but that's just been left out there for now. There's also a Radiant Observer ward in the vicinity there. This is a strange ward, to say the least.
It is. It.
It's not providing vision on the bounty rune. It's barely providing vision on the shrine. That's a... I mean, I find that ward to be very inefficient.
Oh, level 1, they've glimpsed Khalnayak and tossed him back. The problem is, Make-Believe is nearby and he hasn't put a skill point into anything. Just yet, Khalnayak is just going to TP out. But yeah, you were talking about the ward that didn't even look at the bounty rune. Since where the safe lane creeps meet at now, I think it's a lot more valuable to just block the small camp. Because that's the easier pull to do, and just blocking out the small camp is going to give such an advantage to the offlaner. In the earlier patch, it was all about those early rotations and people were warding focused on that. I think it's time to reconsider blocking small camps here with your wards. And I'm noticing that more and more SEA and European teams are focusing on securing the small camp. Mid lane, Max opens the scoreboard, getting a kill on the opposing 4 position. Beautiful stuff.
Appa though, he survives for now and he's still got the CS advantage, 6-4 versus Kiko, who's sitting at 2-0. You know, this Ember versus TA matchup is one that could go either way, but I think Kiko's going to have to be a lot more aggressive with the way he uses that flame guard. Gotta constantly use it, get that bottle out early, and his teammates are gonna have to secure him the rune if he wants to stay relevant in this lane. Because with every passing moment, Appa starts to do more and more damage with the refraction leveled up and as well as the melt level up as well. I'd like to see the tiny rotate mid sometime soon, possibly to make a kill happen on the Ember, but that would mean that Make Believe is left versus Khalnayak in a one-on-one. Khalnayak's already having a ball of a time here. He's got the creep wave under his tower. He's up to level 2. He's going to pick up a bounty rune, and he's not going to lose too many creeps on the way as well.
Yeah, you spoke about him getting points in refraction. He's getting a lot more EXP in the mid lane, and Kiko without a salve might have to make a base trip here. But
top lane though. It looks like we could see a kill on Dream. If Dream is if he steps out of position and gets hit with the Desolate hits, he could well go down here. Yeah. He's got the Hoof Stomp. He's choosing not to use it just yet. Finally gets it off there. But Punk is still chasing. So too is Butter and Actrid. They're going to run him into the trees. Dream, uh-oh. I think he's gone for a bit of a ring around the rosy play here.
He could sell, but what? He just juked them. I don't know who went ring around the rosy here, but Butter caught up. The crush was there and Dream kited, slowed down and brought down as well.
A slow and painful death for the centaur there. No real creeps lost for Akrid either because the equilibrium is still outside away from the tower.
Really, this is pretty much a wasted one. It's giving him no information of anything at all.
Absolutely.
Not sure who placed that one.
Blue Frog's going to move up top now to help his centaur buddy out. And now we could see some of those toss into Hoofstorm shenanigans. He has crossed level 2 after all. And Akrid is low on HP. They could make a kill happen here.
Yeah, 500 HP is a possibility. The easier kill would be the Crystal Maiden.
Blue Frog, he's a little... I mean, his thought process doesn't seem to be on the same length as Dream, because Dream has already gone in and started creep skipping by himself. If Blue Frog was in the vicinity, they could have tossed the center onto the Crystal Maiden.
Now wouldn't be a bad time to go when Punk is... Okay, Butter's coming as well. Blue Frog could...
They saw him. They saw Blue Frog. Butter saw him and backs away immediately.
So one of the key things of playing a 4 or a 5 position is not wasting your own time. And at the very least, Blue Frog should be aiming to get levels as much as possible and not lose out in terms of levels. He's still hunting for a kill with the Centaur. With Max in the vicinity, it could be possible.
Appa's been quite efficient himself, by the way. With the creep wave beyond his tower and with the tiny missing, he's just gone into the jungle, stacked a camp and started farming. Blue Frog with the boots, is he going to be able to catch up to Punk here? Punk just turns with a Crystal Nova and now they're going to shoot a dagger out at him as well with Butter coming in from behind. The avalanche is used, but the glimpse, he actually dodged the avalanche because of that glimpse. The crush could come through, the toss was there, sending him back to Kiko who gets stunned up by the crush again, but Blue Frog is still being chased. Can Akrid make something happen here? Apparently not, because Blue Frog has a salve and Dream is in the vicinity as well. All he's really got is a toss. No avalanche available again, so the fight will fizzle out with no one dying. But yeah. As I say that, Akrid gets jumped again.
Akrid does have a salve, so he's going to be okay. Tango's through as well. A lot of pressure early on the Spectre. It is paying dividends to some extent because Make Believe is doing rather well for himself in the safe lane in terms of CS. Mm-hmm. Every time he sees Khalnayak, walks up to him and with that feast here.
Is this the first game we're seeing Kiko in the middle lane, by the way? Because he was playing the 1 earlier on. Before that, I believe he was playing the 4.
Yeah, I mean, so Akramaks have made more changes than we can remember, or heck, even they can remember. I do think there was one game where Kiko played mid, but top lane, Dream needs to be careful. The crush is there. Dream, left alone by his supports, will end up going down. This is the second death on the center. And this is inefficient support play. They aren't securing the safe lane, they aren't securing the off lane. Yeah, what are
honestly,
they doing?
Blue Frog and Max have just been running around doing absolutely nothing in this early game.
You gotta secure one of two lanes at the very least.
The point is, you just throw one hero next to the center and you're guaranteed a return kill. No one was there while that chase lasted for so damn long. It's really disappointing stuff coming out from the supports.
Yeah.
But middle lane seems to be doing all right.
Blue Frog, he had an opportunity to toss in Khalnayak towards the lifestealer, but didn't bother. Went for the bounty rune and said, yeah, the mid lane, he is winning, pretty much.
Well, I mean, she did go into
she's
the jungle
pushing,
and take
she's
down
going
some
into the
creeps,
jungle, yeah.
But Kiko's still ahead in terms of net worth, because he's got pure lane creeps, right? And he's also got 2 assists for himself. Khalnayak, he stole the Invis rune right under Kiko's nose and now he's tagged him, tailed him, watched him go back as Appa continues to farm. I think at this rate, Appa's going to pull ahead. And yeah, you can already see him on top of the net worth.
Once again, support's not there. Dream does get the hoosh thumb. There's the TP coming up from Max. Akrid doesn't want to chase. They could glimpse them back if they had any mana on their disruptor, but they don't.
I think the difference this time is that Dream had infused raindrops. So he takes a little less damage from the Crystal Maiden as well as the Spectral Dagger, which helps him just walk back onto his tower. Now with the infused raindrops and the Tranquil Boots, he'll regen up once again. He's okay. I don't think Dream dies in this lane anymore, unless something goes horribly wrong.
So there is this interesting synergy, this explosive mid-game for the Akramaks, which is not just limited to tossing the Centaur in, but tossing the Centaur in with a Lifestealer infested inside.
Bottom, speaking
of
tosses.
Yeah, the Gondon and Kalnag, the open wounds is there. You've got the Avalanche as well. Kalnag trying to man fight here. Slams the ground with the Enchant Totem. Make believe, doesn't have the armlet just yet. Not even an Orb of Venom. Kalnag is not easy to bring down. Max though in the top lane, he's going to fall. Dream with the double edge might get a killer response. And yes, he does.
Questionable stuff from Blue Frog there. He held on to the toss till it was way too late. Perhaps with the toss damage and the disable, they might have gotten that kill on the Earthshaker.
Yep.
Especially if he tossed him back to the range creep where the Lifestealer could have been waiting for him. But because of that, the Earthshaker survives. Dream gets one return kill though, which is actually a big deal. Because he's now up to level 6 as well.
Yeah.
So despite those two deaths, he's done okay. But at mid, look at Kiko. He's taken a beating himself, as Appa's even going to find himself a rune. A haste rune at that. In fact, he's thinking of going for the kill here. He's going to walk straight into Max, who has that Thunderstrike. He's also got a glimpse. One hit, two hit, make it three, and then he'll be sent back. With the Blindstone, if he had the Blightstone on him before he went for that, I think he'd have got the kill.
On the DM?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I'll stop looking. You've got Butter waiting in the wings again. Thinking of making a play here, but Centaur is just too tanky at this point. I don't think they scored this kill at all.
I mean, it might be the Akramaks going in. Stampede, Hoosh, Storm, Kiko's here. Avalanche as well. Toss to follow. A couple of quick remnants. And Blue Frog gets the kill. They're looking for more. Punk isolated the chains and cooldown. Blue Frog has a tree. Could toss the Centaur. Will toss the Centaur. And with that double edge, they bring down Punk as well. While Kalnayak fell down on the other side of the map to the Lifestealer and the Disruptor.
All right.
The Akramaks have woken up.
About damn time. I mean, it only took them about 9 games to wake up, but they're doing really well this early game.
Yeah, it's this game is their chance to prove everyone wrong. And so far, they're doing a pretty good job. There is a certain ease of execution to the draft. Toss heroes in, can't go too wrong with that. And they halt Spectre's item progression. The good news is that Make Believe has had untested farm. Nobody's really contested him just yet. Kiko's trying his best, but there's only so much an Earthshaker can do.
Kalnayak, he's still making progress towards his Blink Dagger though. They've done okay in the offlane so far, but so too has the Centaur, right? Because Centaur's almost finished up a Vanguard. What was unfortunate for Akrid there is that he was so close to picking up that Vitality Booster and completing his Vanguard. But they sense that...
toss once more. Crystal Maiden being controlled by Appa's here along with Butter. Someone's going to pay, and it's going to be Blue Frog. His killing spree taken away. Dream recognizes that all the stuns were on cooldown and just TP's back to base. They got Punk, but they gave away Blue Frog's killing spree. Not ideal.
And that too to Akrid. Meanwhile, Kiko's going to find himself a double damage rune now. And that means that Appa should consider playing it safe. There's also a Disruptor in the vicinity, so... if Appa is not careful, he could end up dying. But Appa's going to be careful. He's just moving back to the jungle, where he's going to farm some creeps, ancient creeps rather. He's rushing the Desolator this game. He recognizes how important it is to have physical DPS and armor reduction. But come mid-game, I gotta say, it gets a little scary for the Yakshas. You've got so much control coming out. Searing Chains, Hoof Stomps, Avalanche, Disruptor with everything he throws. And then you've got a fair bit of damage from the Lifestealer to be pushed out. Up until they get BKBs on the side of Yakshas, I don't think they're really secure at all.
Yeah, they're going to need BKBs, and that's when it's make-believe's time to step up and dole out the physical damage.
Mm-hmm.
He's got the armlet complete. And if they want to keep the space up, they've just got to start going with these infest bombs. Blue Frog has got the arcane boots. They have more than enough to keep fighting in this mid-game.
Mid, looks like they're going to go, they're going to haunt in as well. Max,
oh,
he does
stampede.
Have the stampede to save him, but the Fisher will stop him in his tracks. Akrid, however, stuck behind the kinetic field.
He goes here, and he does get stunned for a second, but the roots are there upon the Earthshaker. They force out the horn, they ensure that the disruptor survives, they're wasting Akrit's time, and they get a kill on the Earthshaker,
whose blink dagger has now been delayed once more, while the Centaur continues to make progress on the top lane. Centaur, he's going for the Vanguard first, so it's not really one of those arms race situations between the offlaners where they're both rushing blink daggers to see who gets it first. Centaur's okay with just tanking up, as long as he's got Blue Frog next to him to compensate for that blink
dagger. Blue Frog throws him into battle. You don't need that early blink. The Vanguard's gonna help versus all the physical damage coming up from the side of the Yakshas.
Akrit, however, has just queued up his long-term items, right? He's got himself a phase boots and then it's just the Radiance. No hesitation.
Look at this, top lane. They're prepping.
Can they kill Akrit?
I don't think so. Four levels in double edge, still not enough. They might need Kika or make-believe to move over. So Punk has noticed what's going on and Punk has just been missing from the map. He's also, well, it is still the early game, but he's been rather quiet himself.
At this point, I think Punk is not going to really add too much value in this gank. Maybe if they get one more TP in, perhaps from the Earthshaker, that's when they can turn
around. Oh, they've gone in. I was just going to say that this is right next to a tier 1.
It's not
and
enough.
TPs could come in.
That Vanguard and that point in dispersion is way too much.
But they could go again. They're going to do just that. Dream tossed in, acted with the dagger, trying to move into the trees. But a glimpse is there. And Kiko awaits with the chains, with the remnant. Is it enough? The toss will seal the kill. While Appa manages to bring down Max. Two-man Avalanche, two-man Hoopstorm. They've eliminated Punk. Blue Frog tosses the tree at Appa. A kill on the TA could be huge. She's not burning to the embers, Flame Guard, and Kiko might just have to run. Butter giving chase, and Butter caught in the chase. Blue Frog with the toss, but the refraction keeps Appa alive. He's throwing things at the Templar Assassin left and right, but she just won't fall. They've got to back off. They've done more than enough damage, and the tier 1 will fall as well. Beautiful stuff coming out from the Akramaks.
All this while, Make Believe has just been doing his own thing. So it was essentially a 4 versus 5 on the top lane. They get a tier 1 tower. They get a bunch of kills, including the one kill on the Spectre, if I'm not wrong.
Yeah,
And Make Believe continues to farm.
So this is what I love about Ucypher. I mean, every team came here with a usually momentous start, winning a lot of games, or came here losing a lot of games. I'm going to get back to that top lane. Kiko might be in a bit of trouble. He does have three remnants, none of them to escape though. The root is there. Turns around, gets the chains and gets out. But yeah, every team has come and had a mixed start. A couple of teams applied themselves, like the year does. And that's what brought them where they are. It's all the mana coming in from Rishabh, who worked really hard, took a look at the game, took a look at his team, figured out what needs to get done, switched positions, and made things work. The Akramaks have done the same thing, and it's working out so far in the early game. Let's see if they can keep this momentum going.
The only problem with Akramaks is that it took them too long to find their groove, and now that they found it, heck, who knows? They might just take it all the way to the finals.
Yep.
Kiko, interesting stuff coming out from him. He's recognized that armor reduction is the play here on the side of Yakshas. He's picked up a medallion for himself. That's a little bonus armor coming out from the chainmail component. And he's got the boots of travels first. He wants to fight and make space and make sure that the Spectre doesn't grow quickly enough. Bottom lane's in trouble. Make Believe could be the one getting jumped upon, but it's actually Kiko that joins Make Believe to take a tier 1 tower. While Yakshas are just left clutching at straws, trying to find Akrit some farm, but with the threat of Dream and Blue Frog in the vicinity, how do you farm without being scared?
The good news, okay, there is no good news. Dream's gone in. The problem is this is next to a dash line.
Yeah.
I've seen the Akramaks make this mistake in the past and get punished. They're lucky that they have Stampede. They're extremely lucky that Kalak's not there with his blink. But Butter, with the Psionic Trap, slowing down the Centaur. Dream just pops the Stampede, gets hell out of there.
Look at the wasted time though, because bottom Khalnayak dies once again. His blink dagger, however, has been purchased.
Yeah,
he did purchase
his blink dagger.
But, I mean, this is Akramaks all the way. They get a tier 1, they get a kill on the bottom lane, they force out rotations to the top side, and all they do is pop a Stampede and run. Great stuff coming out from Akramaks. They've found their groove here. Yakshas have been caught blindsided. I mean, they probably got complacent because of Akramaks' poor performances so far, but now they're eating it in the face.
Smoke coming out from the Yakshas. En route to do what most teams at Ucypher do excellently well.
Just the first of many to come. Roshan.
Glimpse, top lane on Akrit. I mean, Roshan is nice, but there's a Static Storm awaiting Akrit. Does he have enough to get away?
He does,
while Butter manages to kill off Blue Frog. So I think they know that Roshan is up. Now they're moving to the Rosh Pit, Stampede's on cooldown, Akrit can heal up. They do not have the tiny for that easy initiation. Make believe though, has a double damage rune, walks into the pit. There's no detection. Has Max got sentries? Yes, he does.
Oh,
he drops one.
They should know.
They just move into the pit. They see Appa. Appa does have the reflection, but the hoof storm's there. A kinetic field on the floor. Chains on the back from Kiko, the Fisher. Buying the TA some time. They're moving on to Butter. Butter dropping low. His sprint kicking in. It's still not level 4, but the avalanche is there. The toss as well. They've eliminated the Slada. Punk wanted to go for the freezing fields. Does manage to channel it, but make believe brings him down. Beautiful stuff coming out from the Akramaks. And this is the first time in the entire course of the tournament that I've seen Mithil enjoy his team playing Dota 2.
Well, tier 1 and mid goes down. They're going to go back into the Rosh pit now. I believe the DD rune has worn off, so they shouldn't be able to take this quickly enough. If Yakshas are ready for this, they can jump in. Khalnayak's got himself that blink dagger, and Akramaks will back away. They're showing some discipline here. They're showing some composure. They're just going to deward the high ground and then move back.
But they're going for round 2 again. Blue Frog throws in the center. Hoof stomp, double edge, avalanche. Stampede, bit of overcommitment. But why not? Haunts on cooldown.
Earthshaker, he's going to go down at the middle lane as well.
6,000 net worth. 17 minutes in.
This is massive. I mean, if there was ever a way to deal with the Spectre, you get this much of a lead and then just continue onward with it.
Yeah.
You can sense the urgency coming out from Akramaks. They've done their homework coming into this game. I don't know what they've eaten and come, but it's working because the pep talk has worked behind the scenes. Kiko's probably the one making the calls here, I'd assume. He is the in-game captain. And, you know, with the urgency that's kicking in, they're constantly making ganks happen, constantly looking for objectives, taking tower after tower and defending Roshan with all they've got. Now with the Haunt offline for 46 seconds, I'm not sure if this is such a good idea from Yakshas. They're choking, man. There's no better way to put it. They're just choking on the main stage.
And Zendos picked up his Blink Dagger as well. Yeah, it's been one of the quietest games coming up from the Yakshas, but they are known to be masters of turtling. Roshan could be exactly what they need to get back into the game. Butter leads the charge.
Meanwhile, Kiko.
Kiko needs to be careful.
Right,
he's TP'd into a shrine and Butter's awaiting him. Echo Slam, Crush, everything to bring down the Ember Spirit. Akramaks got complacent, gave away a huge streak. The question is, can they find a trade?
Well, truth be told, I don't think they could have known that this was happening, that there was there were four heroes waiting at the shrine over there. That space created for Akrit. He's going to get closer and closer to his relic. But this is one of those games where I don't think the Radiance means the end of the game for Yakshas. I mean, I don't think the Radiance means an auto win for Yakshas here. They're going to need a lot more. We've seen how the Centaur can be an absolutely valuable asset versus the Spectre. All he's got to do is build a pipe this game. I know it seems counterintuitive given the physical DPS coming out on the side of the Yakshas, but a pipe versus the Radiant Spectre is going to add a lot of value.
Coming out from Akrit. Static Storm committed in haste. Butter looking for the crush. Avalanche will hold him back. Static Storm committed. Haunt committed as well. Appa picks up Aegis. Can they contest?
The Infest Storm
on to 2 with the Infest out. They bought down Punk. Appa's all by himself. He's fighting. Open moons upon him. And Make Believe is more than happy to take this fight. They lose the spree on Centaur. They take away the Aegis on the TA. While Kiko just runs down the Spectre. Kiko looking for more. Tossed ahead by Blue Frog. The chains are there. And he brings down Butter. Kalayak on the run. He doesn't have the Echo Slam. Can Blue Frog throw another body at him?
What happened to Akramaks? Honestly, I'm left flabbergasted here because they're just playing some fantastic Dota. They gave up the Aegis, but they knew it was a fight that they could have taken. The Centaur basically tanks up the entire Aegis from the Templar Assassin in that fight. And then it's just cleanup duty on aisle 3 for Kiko and the boys.
Yeah.
Blue Frog, this tiny 4 position pick is working out wonderfully for them. Yakshas were not prepared. However, that said, Appa now has the money for his own Blink Dagger. That's going to give him the mobility to get in behind enemy lines and snipe off a hero or two. We're yet to see those massive buttloads of damage being dished out with the corrosive skin as well as the corrosive armor as well as the meld.
The Desolator.
Hits. Yeah.
They're looking for it. They popped a smoke. They don't have the Haunt. Akrit, 1,000 plus gold away from his relic. Make Believe shows himself in the mid lane. Now he has a huge item coming out, but Butter's going to punish.
There it is.
There's that damage he spoke of. Corrosive Haze. Make Believe with a quick Infest. No Stamping to keep him alive. He's looking to bring down Punk, but the last meld hit from Appa secures the kill.
I like how Punk just lifts his skirt and runs the moment the Lifestealer Infests in.
Blue Frog and Kiko get Akrid though. So I
Oh wow, that's worth it.
I think this works.
Akramaks, that's totally worth it for the Akramaks.
Yeah, and Blue Frog has a blink as well. Now they're on the hunt for more. I don't think they can find Kiko. Blue Frog is throwing Disruptor so that he gets the hell out of there. Butter runs in, it's an illusion. Max isn't going to fall for it.
No, they are.
Oh, they are. Echo Slam on to do the Stampede is there. The Fisher, the Enchant Odin, they couldn't ask for better initiation. Kalnayak brings down Max, but Kiko gets him in exchange. Kiko with the Blade Mail, with the Flame Guard. But Appa's come in. He's being tossed by the Tiny, turns around towards him and brings down Blue Frog. Kiko, tagged by the Corrosive Haze, has got to respect the vision that the Akramaks are playing against. And ends up going down. Did Appa jump in?
Why was he just waiting there? He should have known that there was a Corrosive Haze upon him. I don't know why the hell he was still waiting there. Now Dream's going to come in for round two. No Stampede, but he has the Blink and the Hoof Stomp.
They could go in on Appa. I see two-man Hoof Stomp. It's going. They were waiting for the Infest. Make-believe didn't go in, but Open Wounds onto Appa. They're under tier one. They have vision. They take the streak. But hanging around on the sidelines. Not counter-initiating, and they're moving on to Punk. Punk looking for the TP.
Oh, the bash.
And the double edge. They get the kill on a Punk.
This is getting intense here. In this knockout game, Akramaks still maintain a 5k net worth lead, but Akrid has gone back to farming again. The time bomb is ticking. The Radiance is nearing.
I think all Akramaks need to do is just probably group up and push. Leave Tiny on the front lines. TA is not going to come and push him back. He can pop the Rage. They have sufficient tools to start sieging. At least tier 2s, if nothing else. I like what Max did just now. It's quite clear that next Roshan is what both teams will be targeting. He placed the ward. It's not too effective. It's sort of effective. Kind of looks at the rune. But yeah, they're prepping for their next objective. Blue Frog standing on the side, Tiny infested, lifesteal infested inside of him. Yeah, this tier 2 is going down contest, without contest. Yeah.
No contest. Akrid still farming slowly but surely on the top side. His Relic is coming online in a bit, but it's 23 minutes in, and honestly, I think Akramaks have done more than enough damage to slow him down. They're looking at a tier 2 of their own. With Tiny picking up the tree, they should get this tower quite quickly. The question is, are Yakshas getting anything else in exchange? Appa's farming stacks, Kalnayak is farming the jungle, no other buildings being pressured on the other side of the map.
They're getting time for their next items. Their next items is probably going to be that Relic into the Radiant Sunacrid. Is Appa going for the BKB? Yeah, thank God. He needs it.
Maybe the real worry factor here for Yakshas is that they haven't taken a single tier 1 tower this game. So even if they want to go ganking, it has to be on their side of the map.
Yeah. I mean, the best you could do if you're the Yakshas now is try and react once you pick up the Radiance.
I think the other problem with not having taken tier 1s is that Roshan gets significantly harder to contest. Yep. Kiko is going to go for that tier 2 at the middle lane now with the rest of his team in tow. Max, they're going to tag Kalnayak, they'll toss him up, they'll throw him down, the Static Storm is there, and they've caught the Slaughter next to him as well. Dream goes in, they get the kill. That's both the initiators just deleted from the side of Yakshas.
Beautifully done. That was a treat to look at.
Hyper-aggression coming out from Akramaks. They're just tilting their opponents. Yakshas. At this rate, they ought to rename themselves into Chokshas.
Yeah. And now they're going for the last tier 2. That's what seems to be the plan. I'd like to see them do this with a little bit of vision. Maybe around the shrine, maybe behind the tier 2 that they're going for. That would really help their cause because the Earthshaker is going to respawn. He's going to respawn with the Echo Slam, but is going to respawn with his Blink Dagger.
So Akrid basically just stayed alive till he got enough passive gold to pick up a Relic.
Okay.
The courier buys it the second he gets the gold. No spare change for the shopkeeper whatsoever. He
this
calls out the Relic for himself.
But okay. Yeah,
I mean, I wonder if Akramaks tilts looking at this because they haven't gone for any Silver Edges of their own. So they don't have a way to deal with the break. They don't really have any True Strike either, except for the Bash, which procs through evasion.
So, intense game going on between both supports. Butter TP'd on his shrine, tried to get a ward planted in preparation of Roshan. But Max, thanks to this early Observer ward which he planted, did manage to scout out the slot and got a D ward off. So, even if the Yakshas want to take Roshan, they have no vision around the pit. Other than this deep
The only real issue is if Yakshas catches Akramaks off guard, they've got the crush, the blink and the crush, the blink and the echo slam and a haunt on top of it. They could decimate Akramaks in a matter of seconds.
You got the Crimson Guard also complete on the center. That's gonna help.
Definitely. He's also going for the Halberd, by the way. So they end up trading a tier 2 for a tier 1 and they'll continue moving with the advantage. That's every single outer tower taken out by the Akramaks 26 minutes into this game. However, Actrid is going to have his Radiance by the time the next fight kicks in. The question is, will Roshan spawn before it? You can see Apple leaving creeps for Actrid as well. There's just a lot of synergy and coordination coming out between these players. The Radiance is what's going to give them a sigh of relief. And Akrid will make sure he picks it up for his team. Meanwhile, Appa's also picked up a BKB and he's queued up a Butterfly. The physical DPS is slowly going through the roof on the side of the Yakshas. Akramaks, I don't know, I feel like they've slowed down a bit too much here.
I mean, they slowed down for the past couple of minutes because they took down all tier 2s. Now, if you look at the Yakshas, if they lose a fight near Roshan without buybacks, they run the risk of losing a tier 3. So, they've got to be careful. I mean, the Yakshas have got to win the next fight somehow, and it seems as if they've got the items that can help them do that. The Blinkered Kalnak, which has been there for a while, but more crucial is the BKB on the Temporal Assassin, as well as the Radiance on the Spectre, which is now complete. Is it going to be enough?
It most certainly could, man.
They've gambled their tier 2s for items.
What's also gone wrong for the side of Akramaks this game is that while they did plant that Observer Ward in preparation for Roshan near the river, Roshan is going to respawn after that ward times out. So the fight in the Rosh Pit could heavily go in favor of the Yakshas. Already you can see them grouping up as if they want to smoke, but it looks like they're not carrying any on them right now. Kiko, it's not like he's scaling too well into the late game either, right? He's gone for the Blade Mail and the Solar Crest. These are early game items coming out from him, which means the only real source of DPS in the late game is the Lifestealer. I actually feel like Yakshas now have the advantage, and it's all because they were waiting too long for the Roshan to respawn. They should have gone high ground when the Spectre didn't have the Radiance. I know it's a major risk, but it's a risk you have to take when you itemize with early game items like a Blade Mail and a Solar Crest on the Ember Spirit.
You think not bother for all tier 2s and just go high ground from a lane?
Or you take all tier 2s and then go high ground from a lane. Actually, the middle lane, they could, after they took a successful fight, I think they could have gone and done some chip damage on the tier 3 there.
Okay.
Maybe forced out some hasty movements from the rest of the Yakshas and then gone back for the tier 2. But they've gone to their own side of the map when they have all tier 1 standing minus the one at the bottom lane. That's absolute waste. It's a waste of map movement. It's a waste of the space that you created in the early stages of the game.
Yeah, now is when you're looking to get vision back and sort of press the Yakshas into their side of the map and look for openings to go high ground. That's what they should be hoping to do here. I think if the Akramaks realize what sort of advantage they're working with, which I'm pretty sure they do, they need to just pick up a gem and try and end as soon as possible.
Akrid could be in trouble though.
Akrid needs to be careful. They haven't seen him. But yeah, I strongly recommend them just picking up a gem, getting vision back, and controlling the area around the Rosh Pit.
Yeah, but as you say that, Butter actually picks up a gem of his own. This feels like Akramaks are slowly fading off momentum. They're losing momentum here, but they see the Roshan.
But there is a Dire Observer, so.
And a TA trap in there as well.
Questionable sentry coming up from Max there. Didn't really need it, but he does drop that Observer, so it's not going to be an easy path of access for the Yakshas if they do want to contest. Have they smoked up? Well, nope, they're just walking around the pit. Kalnak has been spotted. He could be tossed back into the pit. Punk going, dropping a sentry. Look at Blue Frog. He's looking for the opportunity to punish them. Picks up a tree, blinks, goes after Kalnak, tosses him in the air. Dream not following up just yet. Stampede.
Oh no.
The Hoofstorm, not sure if it was there, but the chains are. Appa pops his BKB, looks towards Kiko, which is Remnants away. And Blue Frog with the Four Staff gets off the high ground. Akrid caught with the Ancients. Butter looking to jump in with the Crush, but Make Believe has the Rage. The chains are there upon Akrid. Look at Kalnak, he's not finding the opportunity. The Echo Slam is there. It's upon the Lifestealer, and they get the Tiny as well. They've got to. This could be their way into Roshan. Mixed initiation coming out from the Akramaks there means that they're going to give up Roshan and possibly give up the lead that they fought so hard to accrue.
Why am I not surprised? We call this. The Rosh fight is not going to be advantageous for Akramaks. They lost their Observer Ward on the high ground before they went into the pit. They took a fight after giving the Radiance BKB and Desolator over to the Templar Assassin, and now they're just being punished for it.
Yeah. The Chokshas have outdone the Chokramaks.
Tier 1 down on the middle lane, and suddenly all those towers just look like free gold ready to be slurped up.
Yeah, it's a lot of gold. I mean, now there's no network that separates these teams.
I like the adjustment that Appa's made. He chose to keep the butterfly on the back burner instead going for the Mentor Cell, recognizing the halberd that's now come out on the center Warrunner. The mobility isn't half bad either, but Appa, he'll take a tower and blink away while Butter's there to back him up. That's two towers taken down, a Roshan taken apart as well, Aegis picked up by the Templar Assassin, and a Cheese on the Spectre, who's heading towards a Mantis style of her own. I feel like Akramaks have thrown this away. Look at the gold graph as well. That's a 7,500 net worth change over the last couple of minutes. One team fight on Roshan is all it took them. It was short-lived for the Akramaks, but now they're fighting an uphill battle.
And yeah, Kigo started to pick up items that could help him scale towards the late game. He's picked up the Maelstrom, that's some cheap magic damage, some wave clear. He might have to look for avenues to rat and buy some time for his team. But that gem has proved to be huge. I mean, they pretty much got the D ward, which Maxus are heavily relying on. Dream goes in with the Hoof Stomp, but Butter quick to surge and blink away.
Appa. His BKB complete, Mantis Cell complete, and now he can move towards the butterfly slowly but surely. Perhaps with the Aegis in tow, it's time for Yakshas to try and make something happen. Heck, I actually think they could go high ground once they've got all their spells online. And there we go. They've got the Radiance, they've got the Haunt online, they've got the Echo Slam, everything is online. I don't think the Yakshas should be waiting any longer. I mean, unfortunately, they cannot see the net worth graphs, so they don't know the numbers, but the numbers are now telling us that Yakshas are in the driver's seat once again. And they're grouping up for the top tier one. Why? Because why not?
Yeah, Appa, he's completed the Mantis style. He's going for the Deadless. You think an
Orchid... I thought he was getting a butterfly early on.
Right. Seems to be going for more physical damage. It's working for him. I mean, they're able to bring down the Lifestealer in these fights. They control make-believe with just one Fisher, and the Temple Assassin had more than enough damage to bring him down. Kiko's noticed that the Akshas are still busy with Tier 2s, so he's trying to apply some pressure and force them to come back and defend this Tier 3, which is what...
Akrid could just take care of that himself, though, right?
But could he? With Dream in the vicinity, he could try.
He can. I mean, I don't think Akrid and... I don't think Dream and Kiko can kill off Akrid by themselves. Oh, Dream's been tagged and he doesn't have a TP. Desolate damage is going to hurt him quite a bit here. The Radiance Burn is there to cancel his Blink as well. Now you can see TP's coming out. They want to force out that Stampede from him. And it's going to happen.
Yeah.
Dream's going to run.
Khalnayak is still chasing, chase. Khalnayak is here. His Blink comes off cooldown in
Slada.
The pit.
He's
here
catch
as
him.
Well. Dream.
He got him.
The trees are crushed. Is there. They've caught out the center. And with the corrosive haze and the desolate damage kicking in from the Spectre, they'll get that kill. Beautifully done. And now the Yakshas, they're the ones working with a 4,000 net worth advantage.
This actually works out perfectly for them as well, because they took down the top tier 2, and now they're going to come to the bottom side as well to take a tier 2 here, which is the last remaining tower for the Akramaks. So this, it's turning into a slow and painful defeat for the Akramaks, when they were the ones in the driver's seat for the most part of this game. They've thrown. I mean, when you're up against the Spectre lineup, when you're up against the lineup that's meant to come online later on, you end as soon as you get the advantage. Full points for style for Akramaks, but 0 points for composure and complacency, and well, a lack of complacency. That's all towers down. Roshan is going to reclaim his Aegis soon, but the damage has been done. The Haunt is still available if they want to go. Appa's got too much money though. I don't think he wants to risk it. Probably wants to pick up the Daedalus before he goes up onto the high ground.
Do you like the Daedalus as a pickup? Or?
It's not bad. Okay. It's absolutely not bad because you're relying on physical DPS, and with a corrosive phase on a target, you jump in with a meld.
Yeah.
If she's blessed with a crit, that's a hero deleted right there. The Tiny, the Ember Spirit, the Disruptor, all pretty much vulnerable to that.
smoke coming out from the Akramaks, just wasting their time hanging around. Dream.
What a terrible smoke.
Yeah, it got the Tiny and the Disrupt, honestly. What can they do with it? You know, despite the network charts in favor of the Yakshas, I still think that the Akramaks, if they start a fight on their terms, can still possibly win this game. Butter going in, two-man crush, team nowhere nearby. Actually, Templar is here, along with the Crystal Maiden.
This is the setup they needed. Akrid is pushing out top, and there's four heroes sitting at mid. There is a smoke available on Butter, but he just swapped it out and said Appa's going to go to the Shrine as well. They're going to continue farming because Appa's almost got the Daedalus. Actually, he has the full Daedalus finished up. No sense in fighting without it. But that's a lack of buyback. Look at the top lane though. Ember's going to TP into Kiko to try and... Kiko's going to TP into Akrid to try and scare him. But Akrid just mans up and rips him apart.
Yeah, I mean, if Kiko pushed his luck there and didn't have a remnant all the way back in his fountain, Akrid could have pursued with the haunt. Yeah.
Akrid, he's playing it safe now. He's getting himself inside the trees and over the hills. He's not going to die here. He's out here by himself and he has the haunt if his teammates need him to join. I feel like the Yakshas are waiting a tad bit too long themselves now. Because make-believe is getting a fair bit of money in his pockets and Kiko's becoming quite a nuisance. Split pushing the waves and...
I mean, Appa's getting uncontested farm. They aren't farming that efficiently on the side of the Akramaks. And I spoke about this earlier on. I mean, when you're a team's captain or an IGL, it's very easy to make calls when you're winning. But what happens when you start losing midway? What happens when your plan starts to fail? How do you respond? This is the true test of the Akramaks as a team. And if somehow they manage to come out victorious here, we have possibly one of the strongest contenders in this tournament that we've ever seen. Appa's going for the Moonshard. Has Butter picked up the Night Vision talent? No, he hasn't.
Yeah, that's at the next level. I hope to God he doesn't go for the attack speed because the Night Vision is so crucial.
Yeah. Yeah. Top lane, Kiko, Blade Mail, Mjolnir, Akrid just hanging nearby. Now, Kalnax moving towards the top lane. If they manage to control Kiko and do not allow him to zip away with his Remnant, they could bring him down, but Kiko...
I mean, the lesson to be learned here is that neither team really knows how to end a game. Akramaks managed to find themselves momentum. They couldn't close it out with that. Now, Yakshas have found themselves a little bit of momentum. They're not able to close it out either. The next power spike for Akramaks comes when Dream picks up his Aghanim Scepter. That's when the Stampede essentially renders the Haunt useless for the most part. Essentially renders a lot of the physical DPS coming out useless as well. Maybe with the Aghanim Scepter or Stampede, they could try and make a play for the next time around and Akramaks, who knows, might come out ahead.
Okay, so Kiko's come to the top lane. The first time he tried to just test the Spectre, but now he's got teams. He's got teammates nearby. The Static Storm is perfect.
Whoa,
not exactly the glitch.
Oh, the Manta
by the Manta style. Akrid though, trying to turn this around. But a two-man crush. Look at that damage from Appa. Make believe low as well. Akrid cleans up the disruptor. Moving on to the Lifestealer. And with the Fisher, with the damage coming out from the Templar Assassin, they'll get the kill. Finally, for the first time in 39 minutes, I've heard Punk open his mouth.
RTZ level shit right there.
Yeah.
Manta dodging a glimpse to turn a fight around. Next level. Akrid, take a bow, my friend. You've led from the front lines and you have pulled off something amazing here at Ucypher Season 1. That's three down. A buyback expended on Kiko. There's a buyback on the Lifestealer as well, but they're just charging in, riding the wave of euphoria, going up onto the
but
tier
went
3.
For the Daedalus,
zoning
the
Kiko out
damage,
with a dagger.
Right. More attack damage.
That's going to be base
fight like this with Spectre with on your back. It's a great way to attack.
Okay. But it's also got a BKB on the slot.
But on
Blue
the
frog,
other hand, the Akramaks, Kiko
well,
was playing Ember Spirit.
Ended up taking more damage,
I believe. Would have helped them in a team fight, but he did not.
Black is waiting. This could very well be the end of the road.
Oh my god, this game of Dota 2 is clearly
keeping
all of us on our feet.
It's on to 3.
I want you guys to not miss out on any more of the game. So as
Dream
says,
dropping low. Well, Appa, instead he's focusing make-believe. Make-believe has no way to get out of there. He's dead. That's a dieback on the Lifestealer. The Halberd comes in a bit too late. The Static Storm, though, will ensure that Slada falls. Dream goes in with the Hoosh Storm. They're controlling the Templar Assassin, but it's Akrid's turn to chip in. He's moving in after the Centaur with that dagger. The Kinetic Field is going to ensure that Appa can't chase, and Akrid barely makes it out of there. The Barracks still stand. Double Siege Wagons doing their work, but Akrid wants to go back in. And Appa ends up falling That I'm not sure what that was, but Akrib doesn't even get the kill onto the Disruptor. He's running straight at him, will finally bring him down. It is a defense of sorts. It is a dieback on the lifestealer.
The barracks dropped, though. The barracks dropped to a siege creep, though. Dream tried desperately to bring it down, but I think Yakshas are okay with that. Spectre survives. It was two buybacks on the side of Akramaks. They get a lane of barracks, essentially, and they're going to come back with new items on the Spectre, who's now picked up the full Abyssal Blade. Akramaks, sure, they found a bit of recovery there, but they know it as well as we do. They're one step closer to the edge now.
Yeah. They did retrieve the gem, though, from the Sludder. Small but significant victory. Not saying that Butter just can't buy another one, but it's a little bit of time for the Akramaks to regain some lost vision across the map.
And guess what? Roshan's back. Yeah. So they could go take the Aegis, the cheese, and come back in. The Refresher Shard as well. This one would go over to the Spectre, I hope.
I do.
Double Haunt would be fantastic for Yakshas.
Kiko goes in. Testing the waters here. Kalnag quick with the Enchant Totem. But Ember just zips away.
Maybe an attempted Yules there would have killed him. Anyway, Blue Frog, it looks like he's not transitioning into a carry at all. He's just getting the BKB to survive. Mm-hmm. Although I'd have liked to see the Assault Cuirass instead. How's the life?
Well, you got the
looking?
Completed Acceptor on the Centaur. So that's definitely going to help.
Not sure if you had it in the last fight, though.
I'm not sure either, but this might just be the last fight of the game. If they don't contest Roshan, it could very well be the end of the road here for the Akramaks.
Appa doesn't have a TP, though, so taking Roshan is not as easy without him. I don't know why the Slada went and started right-clicking Roshan without Appa in the vicinity. Yeah. That's pretty stupid.
I mean, Butter being the IG, just trying to lead by example. Guys, if I'm Roshan, you guys should be here as well.
Akron's going to start the onslaught on him, though. They've also got the Corrosive Ace coming out once more, and Appa's almost here. No contest coming out whatsoever. Akramaks will have to give this one
no
up.
No wards near the Rosh Pit, no smoke on any of the supports. They're giving up Roshan, and they're not forcing a tier 3 at the same time. They've wasted the time. They did manage to push out the top lane. So that's something working in their favor. So, but look at this.
A quick
smoke coming up from Butter. He sees the courier, doesn't go for it. He's trying to move into the
base.
No,
you know what they're doing, right? They're waiting for the courier to buy its item and then they're going to try and snipe it.
Okay. And whose item is that?
Not sure.
Is it the lifestealer? I don't know. He's sitting on 2,000 gold. They're waiting for the courier to come back.
It's going to take the long way around. They won't find it.
It's got a Hyperstone.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, a couple of Templar Assassin Illusions working on the top lane. Akrid's got a double damage rune. Appa in the mid lane. Tier 3 dropping fast. No response just yet. Hoofstorm comes out from Dream. Quick Glimmer Cape. Hoping to keep Appa alive.
Appa's the one with the Aegis though, so I don't think he really cares about taking a few hits like this. Butter's in.
Oh,
he's jumped into
in
the fight.
He's caught make-believe. Appa not committing. They're focusing objectives here and it's working for them. They've got Aegis, cheese, whatnot. Dream goes in. Gets
haunt
the Hoofstorm. There's the Haunt. Make-believe, forced to run back. There's the Stampede, but Butter with a quick crush catches the Centaur in place. Akrid focusing him down with the Meldit. They bring down Dream. 80 seconds without a Centaur. Akrid has the Refresher Shard, pops it. Kalnag just drops an Echo Slam on literally nothing and no one.
No one
would catch that, but yeah, we did. There's Haunt number two. Appa's dropping low. He's got the Refraction. He's focusing the melee barracks.
Max
and forcing all of them back. Appa jumps onto Kiko. Kiko, the chains don't connect. Appa still forcing the barracks. Make believe trying to find his way into this fight. He wants to defend his barracks, but he falls to Appa, who still got the Aegis on him. Akrid tossed into the air, pops the cheese, and they're moving for the third lane of barracks. Appa's got his BKB. It's up to the Tiny and the Ember. And how do they defend? The chains will bring down Butter. It'll bring down the Aegis as well. Kalnag dropping low. Akrid just mad fights, hops the Mantra, brings down the Ember Spirit. It's Blue Frog all by himself, caught with the Frostbite. Focused by Appa, focused by Akrid. And trying to run with that Ghost Scepter, Punk chasing him down. He's probably shouting at him while all of this is going on. Butter's here with the Corrosive Ace. Blue Frog, it does harm
you. They're playing with him, man. They're just playing with him. They're letting Punk get the kill. Look at this.
Akrid doesn't care. Akrid's focusing the barracks. The Akramaks. They played well.
They played well. Their early game was good, but...
Their early to mid game was good.
Unfortunately, their hopes have been crushed. You can see the disappointed look on Max's face there. It's a heartbreaking defeat for them, because they seem like they found their stride at the bitter end of things. But Yakshas, the undisputed champion so far, will move into the grand finals to await the victor of Shadedils versus Marksman. It's been a pleasure casting this game for you. A huge congratulations to Yakshas for their victory.